Alright, mapagpalang hapon po sa ating mga tagapakinig. Welcome po sa ating programang Sulong na Bayan. At syempre po, ngayon ay we're so blessed na maiintindihan natin itong mga matatawag nating offers or ito yung mga serbisyo na makukuha natin sa European Union in as far as education is concerned. Siyempre po, gusto natin malaman anong mga courses, anong mga masteral na ino-offer nila, no? So, we're blessed na makakapiling natin sa ating interview today, no less than ang kanilang deputy head ng European Union Delegation to the Philippines. At siguro, she will be joined by another public affairs officer, Ms. Thelma Gicolea. At malaman natin sa kanila, no, kung ano nga po ba itong gagawing virtual European Higher Education Fair sa taong, actually next month na yan, no? October 1 to 2. But syempre, ang main goal po niyan is to attract students, academicians, researchers, and university officials to attend the European Higher Education Fair 2021. So, again, kahit naman may pandemya, syempre, ang kanilang goal still is what? That education is still a universal and an essential need. Di po ba? Tuloy-tuloy ang pag-aaral. We will not stop to learn dahil every day is a learning process. Di po ba? So, ito pong EU delegation will host the second ever virtual or European Higher Education Fair from October 1 to 2. Dalawang araw pala, from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. And they will feature 140 European higher education institutions from 13 member states. Poland joins for the first time. Other member states include Austria, Belgium, Czech Republic, Finland, France, Germany, Hungary, Ireland, Italy, Netherlands, and Spain and Sweden. So ito po will be done online. So this makes the event more accessible to all, ano? Na Filipino students and members of all of the academy and extends its reach to other provinces in the country. So EU has collaborated for the second time with the following institutions and will serve as the regional hubs responsible in further spreading the word about the virtual fair to more Filipino students, lalong-lalong dyan sa Wesleyan Philippines University, sa Luzon, sa Siliman, napakalakas po ng ating mga estudyante dyan, at ngayon sa Xavier, at Ateneo de Cagayan, Mindanao. Meron pang mga ibang pang partners, but we'll know from Ms. Thelma kung sino sila. So let's welcome to our program the deputy head of this EU delegation. Andyan na ba? Siya ay will ask kung anong kanyang nationality, or si Ms. Thelma kung naka-join na sa atin, ano, we'll find out at ang ating technical inaayos pa ng kaunti. All right, she's right here. Welcome to our program, Sulong na Bayan, Ms. Ana Isabel Sanchez Ruiz. Hello.
Hello, magandang hapon po, and thank you so much for having us here today.
All right, marunong siya magtagalog. Magandang hapon po. That's cool. All right, nakasmile. At sa kabila namang linya at via Zoom, nako, ito napaka matatawag nating accomplished at a very young age, ano? Si Kenneth Tua, siya po ay maraming nako na master's degree na nakuha na. So he will tell us kung ano-ano po ito, no? Kasi gusto ko straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak, ano yung mga kanyang tinakap na courses in as far as, I think, architect and other. Okay, first question, Miss Anna. What is it all about, this virtual European Higher Education Fair? Go ahead.
Well, it's all about giving in the shortest amount, in the shortest time as possible, the opportunity to Filipino students, but also researchers and, as you mentioned, university officials and so, mm-hmm. to get to know all they need to prepare the path for studying in a European higher education institution. So we have packed the program over 2 days, well, in reality, 2 half days. Mm-hmm. And we hope that with this, they can get all the information they need, meet all the people, even ask questions directly through virtual chats, etc., so that it's the most fruitful as possible. use of their time.
All right. This year, what is your theme for This Is Fair?
Well, we have a motto, Go Higher with EU. And of course, we present it not only as an opportunity to enrich their horizons and get to know other countries and other systems, but also as a possible path towards professional success.
Okay, everybody wants to be really successful. In fact, the testimony that we will be hearing later on is very, very successful. But moving on to another question, is there like an age limit for the participants joining?
No, not at all. And even high school students who are in university in the next years may obviously register. It's a pre-registration through our webpage, and it can be followed there and in all our social media platforms like Facebook, Instagram, Twitter.
Mm-hmm. So all ages, doesn't have to be like 20, 30, or even like perhaps a friend of mine, she's interested, she's turning 50. She can like pursue a master's degree, perhaps.
Well, mm-hmm. It's never too late to do things that you want or you like, and especially when it comes to higher education, I really think there is no age limit for that.
Mm-hmm. You're blessed. You know why? In the Philippines, the politicians, they take up, even if they're old, they now are starting to realize they need some other courses to pursue. So our country is riddled with politicians who are not, may I say, some of them, not naman all, undergraduate, or they didn't really finish the school that they attended to. But they have time because this is virtual, so that's the good part, and they can enroll. Now, people are listening right now from different parts of our country, Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao, especially our MSU, Mindanao State University is in Mindanao. They're tuning in, and perhaps they can like coordinate with you or other than that the universities you mentioned here. All right? And our listeners are also all over, via streaming all over the world. So we are being heard in the Middle East and America, East Coast, West Coast, and ASEAN countries like Hong Kong, Japan, Singapore, Australia down under. There are a lot of Filipinos. We call them modern-day heroes, the overseas Filipino workers. And they have money. They have, you know, they are the ones purchasing, or they have the power of money to send their relatives and sons and daughters here in the Philippines to study. So you're good. Okay, next question. What courses, so that people would know, fields of study are available in EU higher education institutions? Enumerate it.
Well, you have the whole range of studies available in the EU universities and other higher education institutions. And in addition, I would like to signal that most of these universities are public universities and really affordable. So the tuition in the EU is really affordable. Mm-hmm. When it comes to our fair, we have prepared several webinars on different areas. For example, business, technology, communication, innovation, health, governance, international relations, tourism, etc. Mm-hmm. But for those who may be interested in studying in European Union universities and colleges, they can study anything they want.
Mm-hmm. Practically, you're offering everything from from architecture, fine arts, medicine, etc.
Even Asian studies.
Also Asian studies. Yes, that's very important. Now, you mentioned about the fees. How affordable is affordable? You know, these are hard times. We are experiencing pandemic, and belt is being tightened, so to speak, and they really need to prioritize, which is what to spend or where to spend it, and what really matters. Go ahead and tell us how affordable is affordable.
Yeah, the fees depend on the country, obviously, and the university, but usually the main universities are public universities, so these are institutions that are not teaching for a profit. So the fees are low. And in addition, in the European Union, we have also programs for giving grantships to studies, to students, like Erasmus, for instance, that I think is already well known in the Philippines, because we have had more than 600 Filipino students who have benefited from these grants. So, and these grants cover most of the expenses and also the tuition. So this is another opportunity, and students can learn more in our fair, in the higher education fair. We had 65 Filipino students this year.
Okay. Erasmus program, that's I think availed by Kenneth. Later we will ask him to explain why he really pursued that. But very briefly, what is it all about, the Erasmus? People would want to know, you know, somehow if they can get avail of that, or for free, or even lower than the usual cost. Tell us, what is Erasmus program? It is popular already, but for those just tuning in, what is it all about?
This is a program that was initiated decades ago by the European Union institutions with the goal initially of promoting mobility of students between European Union countries. So, and this was seen as a way of reinforcing a bit the pan-European feeling among students. And in fact, now in the EU is very popular, and you even have a generation of so-called Erasmus children or Erasmus babies, because many students got to meet their current spouses through this program. And then the EU decided to expand this program to other countries outside of the European Union, because we think that besides the great educational opportunities that it gives to students, it's also a way of enlarging their horizons and making people more global and more aware of differences in other parts of the world.
Right, that's awesome.
So it's basically a program to allow mobility through
a grant
for those who would not have needs otherwise.
Okay, when you say a grant, again, correct me if I'm wrong, how free, or rather, do you have to pay somehow for perhaps not the tuition, but what do you have to pay for?
There is a selection process, and then what means is that those students who are selected, then they get to have their expenses covered by the EU budget. It can be tuition, it can be accommodation, it can be travel expenses, it can be a living allowance, etc.
Okay, when you study, let's say, in Portugal, so where will you stay? Is that part of the package that you are offering? Like, where will you live? Yeah. Tell us.
Erasmus grants also cover accommodation costs. And usually, university dormitories in the EU are very affordable, and as well, university canteens are very affordable. You can have a meal for like $3, equivalent to $3 for €3, a bit more. So it's
okay. You were saying the theme for this year's fair is Go Higher with EU. Have you, like, is it like a yearly annual event that you hold in different countries?
It's an event that the European Union delegations all over the world usually organize. But in the case of the Philippines, we are organizing this fair since 2012 on a regular basis, although we had already one in 2007. Altogether, this is our 11th
year in the Philippines, right? You're saying?
With this fair, yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
11th year that this fair is organized. It's the second year that we do it virtually because of the COVID pandemic.
Right, because of the pandemic, we all know that. So, okay, the online fair, what does it offer? What is there, like a webinar? Tell us.
We have country presentations so that every... so that the students can get to know more about the different countries in which they could go study, the ones that you mentioned that are participating this year. And the webinars that I mentioned as well, on around 20 webinars on these different topics, health, governance, tourism, etc. There are also sessions for more information on grantship opportunities like Erasmus that I mentioned, and other programs that we have also to give grants to researchers, for instance. There will be also live chats with representatives from the universities, colleges, and also with alumni and with the scholars. Mm-hmm. And we also have virtual meeting rooms for more bilateral interaction and a virtual networking event on the 1st of October at 7:30 p.m.
And I'm showing it right now. I don't know if you can monitor it, the pictures, the photos that you had, virtual online seminars and the activities that you had in the past fair. It's being shown on our screen right now, Anna. So again, the fair is targeted at two audiences, namely students, academicians, and researchers, and university officials and staff involved in admission and partnership of external relations. So why two audiences? What's that supposed to mean?
Because it's also an opportunity for universities to talk to each other on collaboration, for instance, sometimes. The programs that one student can have in a university in the Philippines, they will be recognized later in the EU, and then when they return to the Philippines, they can continue their studies without a big break. So it's a way so that the universities can also talk to each other, collaborate in programs or in the design of their curricula, etc.
Do you do you have to join to the entire 2-day virtual fair? It's like October 1 and 2.
Yeah, October 1 and 2 from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. And we will have the opening ceremony on the 1st of October at 1:30 p.m. And registration is free at our webpage, eheffilippines.com.
So if you're a lot of people are really interested to know. But I remember very quickly I guested the Education USA officials. The same thing that you're talking about. They offer all these different courses, fields of endeavor, but again, they were zeroing in some other provinces of the country. So are you doing that as well? Not just in Manila, but going towards the different parts of our country?
Yeah, this year, of course, is virtual, so it's gonna reach everyone, no matter where they are, as long as they have an internet connection. Mm-hmm. And an electronic device.
Right.
But we also have three regional hubs, the Wesleyan Philippines University, Luzon, Siliman University in Visayas, and Xavier University, Ateneo de Cagayan in Mindanao. So they are like clusters to disseminate the fair. And we have also several university partners all over the country.
So that's
including Mindanao State University that you mentioned earlier on.
Right, the one I mentioned. I know the chancellor personally because he's been guesting in our program, the MSU, Mindanao State University Chancellor, and Shari Ali. We know him very well. So we can hook you up actually with the Mindanao State University, the most prestigious university in Mindanao. And you wouldn't believe it, a lot of them have the power of the purse. So they can afford, if you know what I mean. Okay, before I move on to Kenneth, another question. So where can everyone go if they'd like to know more about the 2021 European Higher Education Fair?
Yeah, they can go to the website that I mentioned. I will repeat, eheffilippines.com. And they can also register there. And in addition, they can follow it at our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter in EHEF EHEF Philippines.
All right. Okay. We won't let you go. We want just to hear the testimonial of one of the successful grant students that you have for the Erasmus, no? Kenneth, can we have him? I think he's already in via Zoom. Engineer Angelo, I'm sorry, yan. Kenneth, all right. Hello, welcome to our program, Sulong na Bayan. Mukhang susulong na yung bayan, tatagalugin natin for others who are listening, tuning in right now na Taglish, ano? So they would understand you na rin. Ano? Siyempre, Erasmus program, very quickly, what is it all about? Kenneth.
Hi, Ma'am Loli, nice to meet you and nice to see again, Madam Anna. So thank you, Erasmus program po, no, is European Union's program that supports education, training, youth, and sport in Europe, which is, of course, open po siya everyone worldwide.
Okay.
Now, just to be technical po, no, it has an estimated budget of 26.2 billion euros,
okay,
which is nearly doubled from its previous or predecessor program, which is 2014 to 2020.
Okay.
And now, ito pong Erasmus program po, they have many opportunities po, and it offers mobility, kumbaga. When you say mobility po, you get to go to Europe and you get to go around and study there.
Mm-hmm.
And it also has cooperation opportunities in higher education, vocational education and training,
okay,
school education, adult education, youth and sport.
Aba. So all encompassing, ano? Pwede, anybody can join,
po,
ano? So again, what made you pursue? Bakit yan ang tinutukan mo, Erasmus program in the EU?
Well, technically, just to give you some background, no,
okay,
I was looking for a master's degree program when I was of course, in the Philippines pa, when I was still working. I was working in the government po.
Mm-mm.
And when I went to a short program, scholarship din po siya sa Singapore, I met one of the alumni.
Mm-hmm.
And she told me, how about you try the Erasmus program?
Mm-hmm.
And I did try. And one of the reasons why that I really pursued it is because may mga courses po,
mm-hmm,
na only in the Europe so far,
mm-hmm,
they are providing it po. Although,
really?
For example, po, I'm trying to be expert on landscape heritage conservation. Although meron po sa Pilipinas,
okay,
it is still at an early stage, if I may say, or correct me if I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And in Europe, and they are really,
mm-hmm,
opo, parang they have the foundation.
Extensive.
So,
mm-hmm,
for me, that's the opportunity. And of course, as a Filipino,
mm-hmm,
I was thinking that after the program, maybe,
mm-hmm,
I can bring back the knowledge,
sure,
and furthermore, maximize,
diba
po,
right,
in the Philippines.
That's a nice goal, ah. Bihira tayo makarinig ng ganyan. Whatever you learn from abroad or overseas, sabi nga na, brain drain na eh. Dapat naman ibalik dito, diba? Or something.
Opo,
okay, moving on. But what has changed in your life following, you know, this, now that you're in here, your studies?
But technically, yes po, of course, madami po ng open opportunities. I would say not really being cliche, pero mas maganda na tignan yung curriculum vitae. Pero in a sense, it has really boosted my career opportunities and also academic opportunities,
mm-hmm,
po. And that's one of the employers and if you're going to also continue in a PhD, that's when they see Erasmus Mundus or Erasmus program, they know that you're,
mm-hmm,
yes po, they know that you are well exposed,
okay,
and they know that you really went under a lot of well-rounded and very competitive,
mm-hmm,
na scholarship program po.
Mm-hmm. Tell us, very quickly, your journey to the EU as an Erasmus scholar. Englishin muna because Anna, so she can understand us. Go ahead.
Okay. So, technically, my journey in the Erasmus
Mundus,
I would say that the journey is really, really diverse. I might say that I studied in four countries. It's,
mm-hmm,
because the program itself, it's going to be like one semester per country, and namely the countries are France,
okay,
Portugal, Romania, and Italy. And,
mm-hmm,
it's really, when you go to each country, you get to learn their culture,
sure,
you get to learn how they
behave,
do things,
mm-hmm,
like first, yes, how will they behave,
mm-hmm,
and how does the higher education system is there. So it's,
mm-hmm,
really different.
Mm-hmm.
And with this, you actually get to exchange well of your cultures, your learnings, and somewhat you really get to enjoy. Like, for example, another experience would be in France. They really taught me how to savor my food, kumbaga. I really enjoy my food.
Talagang
while in Portugal,
tikim-tikim na maayos, and then talagang namnamin mo, no?
Normally, kasi
every single
bite. Normally in the Philippines we're in a hurry.
Kain. You take for granted. Ito talaga ng ninanam na mo eh. You're like romancing, imbes na romancing the stone, romancing the food.
Or maybe because mahal din, di ba? I'm just kidding.
Okay. Yan, talk about mahal. How did you cope? Kasi syempre, dapat medyo well off ka rin, ano? Kasi iba ang pagkain, rates ng food nila.
Well, actually, because of the Erasmus Mundus Joint Master Degree Program, I really didn't have a problem with the expenses. It's all fully paid expense. The accommodations, the travel, of course, the tuition fee, and all in everything that I needed is there na po. Mm-hmm. So I really suggest it to everyone,
okay.
And
challenge.
You will not really have a problem.
All right, quickly, what challenges?
Challenges will be, normally all the programs are in English. It just so happened that a part of my program is in French.
So you have to study it. The language.
Yes, technically speaking, I didn't have a knowledge at all in French.
Really?
So when I don't have a certificate. Okay. What I did po, ma'am, is that before I flew to France, I studied at least 2 months of French. And I'm really thankful to my professor in the Philippines, Ma'am Frances. And with that said, when I went there, although I have learned it, it's still different kasi it's university level.
Conversational.
Yes, but when you are there, what I'm really thankful is that all your fellow scholars from different countries, they help you actually, and they are more fluent than me, and they really help me. Mm-hmm. So just to end this question of challenges, one thing that I did was able to really cope up in my semester in France is that all my classes were in French. So after classes, I would always double check the notes in English. Right. I would translate it and double check it. So that's the only challenges. But normally, Erasmus program is in English. Yes.
In English. Yeah, but you know, you have to contend with all the people around you, the different nationalities that you are there. So you can like really, there's fusion. You can like really understand each other. Okay, sa ating pagbabalik, we have to come back, Miss Anna. We have to pause for a station break. But Kenneth, don't go away kasi meron pa akong mga itatanong sa'yo para ma-inspire mo naman yung mga nakikinig sa ating possible na mag-enroll at mag-avail ng mga grant. Okay? You guys stay put. All right, the Philippine Standard Time is 3:30 in the afternoon.
Si Miss Loli Acosta, Sulong na Bayan sa DWIZ 882.
All right, nagbabalik po muli ang ating programang Sulong na Bayan at dumadami ang ating mga questions na natatanggap. We still have, syempre, via Zoom, ang ating testimonial from Kenneth J. Tua. Alam niyo po si Kenneth J. Tua, he is actually finishing his master's degree with summa cum laude honors. Etong September, actually, architect and heritage conservation expert. With mention, I don't know how do you say this, mention tres bien. So he studied in 7 universities, learned 6 languages, obtained 5 master's degree, and received 3 online certifications in prestigious colleges. At ngayon, he's undertaking 4 research publication. Si Kenneth Tua also finished his Erasmus Mundus Joint Master Degree in Dynamics of Cultural Landscape, Heritage, Memory, and Conflictualities from France, Portugal, and Romania. Of course, we still have our deputy head of European Union delegation to the Philippines. Still, we are still learning or actually knowing what the European Higher Education Fair EHEF 2021 on 1 October to 2 about it. More about it, but before we go back to you guys, we have online via Zoom. We're glad to have him, an equally talented and smart and intelligent student. Let's know more from him and what questions he will ask you guys, no? Kenneth and Miss Anna. Let's welcome to our program, Sulong na Bayan, the son of Congresswoman Joy Tambunting of Parañaque, Isaac Tambunting. Hello.
Hello. Good afternoon, Tita Loli, and good afternoon,
Miss Anna.
So, Kenneth and Ma'am Anna, it's very nice being with you here this afternoon on the program. Thank you very much, Tita Loli, for inviting me.
Okay, shoot the first question. Go ahead. What do you want to know?
I was listening to the interview earlier, and it made me very interested about studying in Europe, Ma'am Anna. Currently, I am reviewing for the qual exams this November here in the Philippines. I'm wondering, during your fair this coming October, will there be offerings for LLM mm-hmm. programs for law in European universities? Mm-hmm.
Have also information on law studies, including postgraduate studies.
Okay, I see. Thank you. Because I'm also very interested because I have some friends who also decided to take the LLM studies and postgraduate law studies in Europe. Yes.
I have a friend who is actually taking the bar also this November. He is also planning to apply for Erasmus. Mm-hmm. And sakto, naghumingi siya sa akin tulong. Meron pong isang program na master in law sa Erasmus po. At ang head school ay ang University of Glasgow. So kapag after po nyo, pwede po kayo mag-apply and there is an opportunity out there po.
Great.
Okay. Thank you very much, Kenneth, for that info. Thank you so much.
Okay. Any other thoughts that you have in mind? You're in BGC UP, right, Isaac? Is that the...
Yes, I graduated from UPBGC last year, and now I'm studying for the bar exam. Mm-hmm. I would just like to say that I was very impressed with Sir Kenneth's credentials and his academic achievements, and very impressed. So congratulations for that. And thank you very much for the advice that you gave, that it's a possibility to study abroad, mm-hmm. in spite after taking your... law degree, and I'm just curious, how long were you in Europe, and did you have any problem in terms of the culture, getting to know the other people there? Was it a culture shock for you, or was it easy adjusting to the environment?
Maraming salamat po, Sir Isaac. Bali po, yung program po kasi ng Erasmus is very diverse. Kumbaga, although it is from 5 master degree programs actually, and they will confer a joint diploma. Ang naging problema ko lang po siguro is yung pag-i-empake lagi from one country to another. yung rason kung bakit madaling master degree at joint diploma siya kasi really? Per university, they are really joining together to confer a national diploma per semester. Ganun po siya. So, ang hirap po na paglilipat ka, kaya lilipat po ako ng France to Portugal, minsan nakakatakot po, di ba? Ipapadala mo muna yung bagahe mo, tapos hindi ka sure kung darating ba sa tamang lokasyon. So, yun, right? Yun din nga po. Kasi may mga instances na meron akong kakilala po na talagang nawala yung bagahe. Pero, sa pag-iingat na po yun, mga insurance, gano'n. Kumbaga, adulting nga po siya, pero din nga po, ang kapalit naman po nun is, for example, yung scholarship or yung grant. Program na makukuha mo naman po at the end.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see. So thank you very much for your sharing, Sir Kenneth and Ma'am Anna. I'm very inspired now to possibly look into the possibility of trying to study abroad, especially in Europe. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So next time we will siguro marinig namin sa'yo, Isaac, ano ba yan? French na.
Sesua.
Ano, tama ba yung
Bulgaria? Bonjour?
Ewan ko kung ano sinabi ko, Kenneth, ano ba yun? Kanta yun eh. No, just to break the ice. Alam mo, masyado tayong seryoso. But thank you, Isaac. I'll see you soon and say hi to your mom and to your lulay and everybody. I miss them. I'll see you again.
Yes. And we miss you too, encourage. Loli. Take care.
Encourage some of your classmates, the ones taking up the law, para sabay-sabay din kayong magkakabarkadang pumunta doon. Because may Erasmus, imagine. Kenneth was able to get it. And summa cum laude. My gosh, panalo si Kenneth. So thank you, Isaac.
Galing.
All right.
Thank you very much, Tita Loli. Thank you.
Right. Okay. Another question from our listener. I don't know if she can like come in. Lizzie, nandiyan na po ba siya sa ating Zoom? Parang wala, Engineer Fred? That's okay. Ang question niya for Ma'am Anna, are the public universities of Europe something like state colleges in the United States? And that is why they are affordable to middle-income families? Balik mo si Miss Anna.
I don't know the U.S. system so well, okay. So I cannot say if they are exactly similar, In general, in Europe, you have private universities, but most of the universities are public. So it means they are financed directly by the state or by the federal state, depending on the country. And they are considered as a public service. So, and the goal is to make higher education affordable to any person, irrespective of their family wealth. So that's why the the public universities are affordable, so that any student for any level of income in their families can have higher education.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question from Lizzie Lazo again. What diploma courses are available to Asians in this European higher education fair?
Well, the
we'll have to
fair
repeat,
will bring
perhaps she just tuned in. Go ahead.
Yeah, the fair will bring information precisely on that, but what you can see is for those students who will register at the fair, they will get all this information, but they can see that the areas, the academic areas that they can for which they could go to the European Union to study are immense. They can study anything in the EU. Obviously, the law, medicine, archaeology, maritime science, technological engineering, anything you can imagine, you can find a university there with that program.
So she's just to clarify, she's like asking, the European Higher Education Anna Fair is virtual, right? So is it different from the scholarship program that Kenneth discusses right now, or how is it?
Yeah, the fair aims at providing all the information that the students may need. For instance, if they are interested in applying for an Erasmus grant, or if they just want to go to a European university. So at the fair, you won't have the possibility to apply directly for these grants or to apply directly for these studies. But people will get all the information they will need if they decide to try.
To fly. Okay.
And they will also have the opportunity to ask questions and to interact with the university officials and country representatives if they want to ask about the country and the university.
All right. Let's welcome to our program Ms. Lizzie Lazo. She's already via Zoom. Go ahead, Lizzie. Throw your question to Ms. Anna or Kenneth. Go. Yes, Lizzie, you're in. Your microphone, your audio. Can't hear her. Okay, something's wrong with your microphone. Hello, Miss Lizzie. She's a journalist, Anna. She's a featured writer of different magazines and publications in the country, and a veteran journalist at that. We can't hear you. You know how technical a glitch is. Again, sayang. Okay, let me just ask. Pinadala rin naman niya, no? Ang kanyang question. Paki-chat na lang po, Engineer Jeric. Engineer Fred. How can Asian participants help in promoting, Anna, the pan-European feeling sought with the virtual European Higher Education Fair? How can they promote it? Go ahead, Anna.
We don't want to turn Filipino students into pan-European students, but we want to offer. We want to show to Filipino students that this is a academic venue that they can pursue, because sometimes students don't have the information.
Yes,
and they don't really know what is available to them and where they can find the education that they want or the life experiences that they want. So our goal is to show that in the European Union you can pursue a university degree, a postgraduate degree, in a big diversity of countries and universities. And then it's up to each student, of course, to decide what they want to do with their lives. But I think it's always useful, especially for young people, to have as much knowledge as possible of the mm-hmm. of the doors that they have opened, mm-hmm. because life is very complicated, exactly. and information is power in a way, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. and if you don't know, you cannot profit telling. Of these things.
Yes. Again, that's biblical, for my people perish for lack of knowledge. Hosea 4:6. It says that if you lack knowledge, then you're subject to what? Number one, being harassed, being victimized, and then you eventually what? Get depressed and you perish. We don't want anyone to perish. That's why we have this kind of learnings, and nakita naman natin sa testimony. Go ahead and siguro balikan natin yung testimony ni Kenneth. Ano? Napaka-awesome ang kanyang mga experiences, pati sa pagkain na describe niya. Na dapat namin mo yan. Di ba pwedeng take for granted? Eh, dito sa atin sa Philippines, you know how it is. We just eat and eat. So, again, any other parang defining moment the whole time you were there? Kasi you're graduate na of Rasmus eh. Ano yung nakita mong saan ka talaga nag-excel? Landscape? Architecture? Go ahead, Kenneth.
Okay po. Thank you, ma'am. So thankfully po, masabi ko po na per semester po kasi may different na specialization yan. Mm-hmm. Siguro talagang nag-excel po ako sa, nag-excel po talaga ako sa cultural landscapes cultural po, landscape. Yung pinag-aaralan. So, ang example po nun can be Ifugao Terraces po.
Oh, wow.
And
banana rice
one
terraces.
Of the defining, mm-hmm. yes po, one of the defining moments po is that hindi ko po na-expect yung sinabi niyo po kanina, mention Trebian. Actually, mention Trebian is an equivalent to Latin honors of summa cum laude or yes. highest honors.
Highest
and
honors.
Hindi ko po siya na-expect.
Wow.
Pero yung nakita ko po yung grade ko, medyo onting-onti na lang, muntik na ako hindi makuha yung
mark.
Opo, onti mm-hmm. na lang. Mm-hmm. So hindi ko po yung na-expect po. Kumbaga, yung nag-aral po ko for Erasmus, mm-hmm. nag-aral lang po ko on the point of really knowing the expertise that I want.
Mm-hmm.
Then this is kumbaga this like a cherry on top na lang po. And
or a miracle, sabi mo dito, miracle is another name to say it. Miracle kasi
effort.
Gusto mo lang makapag-aral, maka-abroad, makaikot-ikot sa ibang parang Europe. And now suma pa. How did you like really the family, I'm sure your mom, your dad, how did they like reacted?
Well, na-surprise naman po sila. Sobrang sinasayan. Kasi actually, nung college, yung college kasi hindi din po nila ako masyado pinipressure when it comes to studying, which is I really appreciate.
Right. Oh.
Pero nung college, actually, nagtanong sila, parang onting nag-request na mag-cum laude, kaso hindi ko kinaka. So parang,
right.
No, hindi. I mean, sa huli lang po yun.
Right.
Oh,
but
pero yung, kaya
more than that, binigyan mo na summa cum laude. So mas matindi yun. Right.
Mm-mm. Kaya masaya po ako na nakapaibay sa kanila. And I think dapat po masabi ko sa mga kapwa Pilipino ko na average student lang po ako.
Okay.
Kumbaga masasabi ko po na anyone can apply,
mm-hmm.
anyone can try, mm-hmm. And they just really make the most out of it kapag nakuha yung scholarship, kumbaga,
mm-hmm.
or kapag nakapag-experience sila makapag-study abroad nga po.
You're saying hindi ka man lang honor student and yet nakapasok ka dito sa Erasmus grant? Anong dapat na panuntunan? Paano siya para talagang ang mga nakikinig sa atin, baka anak ni Engineer Fred Villamala, average or sabihin na natin hindi naman honor student, pero interesado pala dito. Go.
Masasabi ko po na, maganda po sa Erasmus or European mm-hmm. Union is that titingnan po nilang ang iyong application as mm-hmm. a whole.
Mm-hmm.
Kumbaga holistic po.
Holistic.
Kumbaga yung work experience,
mm-hmm.
extracurricular,
okay.
yung motivational letter niyo po. Kumbaga hindi lang po sila nag-base sa grade itself. Although syempre sana wala kang bagsa.
Right.
Pero mm-hmm. Masasabi ko po na they really appreciate yung nag-a-apply as a whole person. And
mm-hmm.
they really see the passion
mm-hmm.
and yung kumbaga yung idea na kaya niya ba to?
Kaya
Oo,
ba?
Kaya niya.
Oo.
Parang ganun po yun.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Parang ano eh, may somehow, mas scare ka eh. Naku, kaya ko ba ito? Eh, hindi naman ako magaling sa klase. Average ka nga lang. And yet, ayan. So what made you like really parang focus o siguro effort na on your part, ano? Talagang nasa heart mo to enlarge your vision, not settle for mediocrity. Ganun ba yung parang pananaw?
Yes po. And also, another thing po is that kapag nag-aral ka naman po ng master or PhD, normally hindi naman kasi there's this thinking na people would think that they would like to teach, parang ganun po. Uh-oh. Or normally, when you get a master or PhD, sometimes kailangan din po siya to actually excel on your career and professional growth. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that I'm looking at po. Although, mm-hmm. mahalaga din po yung sa academic side, which I really appreciate our professors po kasi there's the one who is teaching us.
Really? Pumped you into that, ano? Siguro, pagporsigihan mo, no? What now year are you working now, Kenneth? May NGO work?
Currently, I'm with an NGO. Okay. Pero wala pa yung parang definite date. But normally, kasi what I do now is consultancies and NGO work. So I'm with International Council of Monuments and Sites, Philippines. Right. It's an international NGO in France. Mm-hmm. And I do consultancies in governments and mm-hmm. also NGOs po, mm-hmm. as a architect and heritage conservation practitioner po.
Ako, dapat siya. Sino ba yung ating number one architect? Si Jun Palafox. What's your take on him? We will not magnify him, pero siya lang kasi talagang somehow pagka sinabi mo architect, the name Palafox is like a tantamount to saying him yun eh. Do you know him? Do you at least
yes, po.
Have research about
Opo.
Him?
I would say na siguro one thing na naalala ko po sa kanya as yung proposal po niya ng Pasig River development. Kasi mm-hmm. po, nag-work po ako sa Pasig River Rehabilitation Commission.
Yes, really.
And I would say na he really has a vision po. Although, sayang, hindi mm-hmm. po siya nasunod. Pero right. I think it is one of those plans na masasabi kong something to look up to po.
Forward to. So what's your vision naman sa atin, the Philippines? Kasi architect. Kailangan na para yung mga dredging dyan, alis na pag umuulan, etc. You know, or zoning, or overcrowding, paalis na yan sa ibang, ano na, you know, countryside development, blah, blah, blah.
Siguro po, gawin ko itong opportunity po. No? Currently po, meron po yatang ipinapopose na Pasig yes. River Expressway. Right. Masasabi ko po na I hope makita po ng gobyerno at ng mga leaders po na hindi po yun necessary po para po matugon na ng traffic kasi madami pong ibang paraan. Kasi sa mga ibang bansa, for example, mm-hmm. yung mga expressway sa taas ng river, sinisira rin po yan kasi nga po meron po sila mga pollution at kumbaga mga epekto sa climate change.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So far, yun po yung pinaka-concern ko po ngayon sa ating bansa kasi napaka-alarming po yun yung Pasig River Expressway na yun po. Mm-hmm. So, yun nga.
Maybe you can like write the government, ano? Yung ating mga talagang nakatutok dyan sa Pasig River Rehab, kung sino man yung head dyan, to, you know, put or give your 2 cents worth. Kasi kayo na yung ano eh, kayo na nakakaalam eh. Galing ka, exposed ka sa ibang bansa eh. So nakikita mo rin yung kanilang infrastructure doon, mga bridges at saka kung ano-anong for landscape and all. So it will help if you can like sama mo na yan sa iyong sa iyong gagawin. Ano?
Write
the government right now because they would need all the help, or actually we all need all the help that we can get. We have 1 minute. Nako, that's all the time we have. It's very, very fruitful. This is so good that everyone now, I am convinced, Anna, that you guys are doing a good job because Kenneth here, our very own Filipino national, has already achieved so much in a span of a brief period of time. Of course, dedication, determination is all there. But again, with the Erasmus program that you have and the other fields of courses that you will be offering and somehow all the package that it will be beneficial to all the students who will be really, really joining the fair or really avail of your courses, the EU education will benefit. So thank you so much. Give us a 60-seconder, Anna, and we'll say goodbye. What's your last pitch, last message? Go.
Well, I invite the Filipino students to register at the fair to know what it is about, what they can get by considering studying in the European Union. And I must also say that of our Filipino Erasmus students, they are all very good. So, and Filipino students always have very good grades and do very well in this program. So I really encourage everyone to look at it and to think of the possibility to study in the EU.
All right. Thank you so much. This is not the last. You keep us posted any update anytime soon, because that's still October 1 and 2. I'll be announcing it again in other programs of my daily program here at over DWIC. So thank you, and God bless everyone, and good luck. And yes, we love Europe, of course, but we want to go there. Thank you. God bless, Anna. Thank you, Arizona and Nancy. All right, salamat po sa ating naging kagafa. Siyempre, Engineer Fred Balamala, si Jello, si Micah, si Hias, si Juday. God bless everyone.
Si Miss Loli Acosta, Sulo, Nabaya, DWIZ 882.